afternoon, United. Welcome to another midweek message with you, United midweek message with Pastor Frank Jackson. As we are approaching Mother's Day this weekend, and we want to definitely give honor to all our moms and those who have been motherly to ourselves and our children. And this week, I want to talk about how God uses messy moms to fulfill His plan. How God uses messy moms to fulfill His plan. I am excited about today's word. I believe there's something for moms out there to help them understand and understand that they don't have to be perfect. God's not looking for their perfection, but He's looking for their dedication. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, Heavenly Father, we come before you with bowed heads and humble hearts, first giving you praise, Father God, for just being who you are, for loving us in spite of ourselves and keeping us in perfect peace. We ask you right now, Father God, to continue to bless, anoint, and touch as we, Father God, give you all the praise and glory for all that you have done. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. How God uses messy moms to fulfill His plan. I think my daughters were, youngest was 8 and the oldest was 16. When I found myself in my walk-in closet letting out a scream of frustration. I don't remember exactly what was going on, but apparently it was enough to make me realize that I needed a timeout. I do distinctly remember that day. One of them had called themselves tattletaling on me to my mother. They told my mom that daddy had said a bad word. Apparently, in a moment of desperation, I told one of them to shut up, a phrase they were rightly forbidden to use, no matter how mad or upset they were. To this day, my children are not allowed to say or tell anyone, or especially an adult, to shut up. No matter how good we try to be as parents, there are simply some days we look back on and stamp with the big red, oh, I could have done better. I'm thankful that God doesn't expect us to be perfect parents or doesn't expect the mothers to be perfect moms. He understands our weakness. Just look at Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15 and 16. And it sympathizes with us that we are not perfect. And as many stories in the Bible illustrate our struggles to measure up as good parents, but especially good mothers, God keeps His sovereign plans from coming. He doesn't allow our messiness to keep His sovereign plans from coming to completion. If we're willing to see our failures from His perspective and adjust our lives according to the truths found in His word, He can bring beauty from our mistakes that will glorify Him and testify to His redeeming grace. Understand that no matter how imperfect you are, God will allow your imperfectness to bring forth His perfect peace. He'll allow your imperfectness to bring forth His redeeming grace. He'll allow your imperfectness to bring forth His mercy. A messy mom is simply a mother who realizes she has made some mistakes and knows she'll never be perfect. Some of us have rather large messes in our lives. Our past might be filled with great regret, with shame, guilt, and disappointments in both ourselves and our lives and how things have turned out. There are others of us who seem to be doing okay. But no matter where you are, God's grace is still sufficient for you. We are able to keep things on the road for the most part, but we never quite feel like we've mastered the art of parenting and are quite aware of our weakness and insecurities that can derail us at any time. Most of us that have been parents for a little while, we realize how imperfect we are. We realize how many mistakes we can make. I ain't met a mom yet that hasn't made a mistake. I haven't met a mom yet that hasn't said something they shouldn't have said or done something they should have done. No matter where We are on the path of parenthood or motherhood or even grandmotherhood or grandfatherhood. We can all be classified as messy parents or messy moms. We might be a mess. We might think that we're making a mess of it all, but all we have is this in common. We need encouragement and we need hope, and we need a hope that comes from the sure confidence in the overcoming grace of a sovereign God. Scripture tells stories of many women who made a mess, many mothers who made a mess of their lives and from the human perspective. But when God stepped in, he took each one and made something beautiful out of their failures. And I just want to share two such stories with you about some messy moms, some messy women who God picked it up and turned it around for his favor. First, I want to talk to you about is Rahab. We first meet Rahab in Joshua chapter 2, when the two Israelites men paid visit to her house on the city wall. Rahab is described as a harlot. A biblical implication is that she either made a living as a prostitute or managed such a house. These men had come to spy out the land, needing secrecy. They chose to stop at a place that would not be unusual for two men to take lodge in. Rahab knew these men were who these men were and why they had come. Stories of their miraculous crossing of the Red Sea years before still put fear of God into her people. While Rahab's lifestyle indicates that she had no understanding of biblical laws, she acknowledged that he was God in heaven and on earth. Just look at Joshua chapter 2, verse 11. She recognized the sovereignty of the Israelites' God. Because she feared this God, she lied to the city officials, hid the spy, and later helped them escape over the city wall. By the world's estimate, Rahab wasn't worth much at all. She was an immoral woman who lied without hesitation, yet God had a greater purpose for her. He took that mess she made of her life and drew out of the wicked Canaanite culture by his sovereign plans. The two spies promised Rahab that they would preserve her life and the life of her family if she would mark her house with the scarlet thread that stayed in the house under its protection. In this way, when the armies of God people took the city, they would know to save the lives of those inside. Rahab had needed to exercise faith by hanging the scarlet thread in order to procure physical salvation for her family. It was an immature, intellectual faith, but all faith the same. It was an immature, intellectual faith, but it was faith all the same. What a beautiful picture of God's redeeming grace. Just like the blood of the Passover lamb protected the Hebrew children when they were when the angel of death was released in Egypt, the scarlet cord reminds us of the blood of the Savior that provides atonement for the forgiveness of sins. And like Rahab, we must exercise faith. A faith in the blood to receive eternal and spiritual salvation. When Jericho's walls fell down, Rahab went to live with the Israelites. Her intellectual acknowledgement of the Israelites' God became a personal living faith as she left her old life behind. She married Salem, a descendant of the tribe of Judah. Look at 1 Colossians chapter 2. They had a son named Boaz, who married a Moabite woman named Ruth, who gave first birth to Obed, whose son was Jesse, whose son was David, the beloved king of the Messiah, Jesus came. Not only that, but Rahab is one of the only four women named in the genealogy of Jesus in Matthew chapter 1. She's listed in the Hall of Faith in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 31. And her decision to save the spies is described as a work of faith in James chapter 2, verse 25. Even though she did it imperfectly, Rahab's checkered past didn't prevent God from using her for his sovereign purposes. Neither you nor your past can keep God from using you as a mother who makes the eternal difference. If we turn away from our own lives and give ourselves completely to a new life we find in Christ, God can use just as he used Rahab as a picture of redeeming grace. Yes, your imperfectness can be used for God's perfecting. But the second woman I want to talk about is Tamar. Tamar's story is found in Genesis chapter 38. She married Ur, the firstborn son of Judah. Ur had two brothers, Onan and Salah. The Bible says that Ur was an evil man, and the Lord took his life. In Hebrew culture, they practiced a custom called levirate marriage, where a woman would marry her brother-in-law upon her husband's death. When a man died without a child, a man's unmarried brother would marry the widow in order to provide her an heir for the deceased. A widow would marry a brother-in-law, and the firstborn son produced in that union was considered the legal descendant of her dead husband. Judah orders Onan to fulfill his obligation to Tamar, but he disobeys, and the Lord takes his life also. The youngest brother, Salah, who is not old enough to marry, so Judah sends Tamar back to her father's house to wait for him to grow up. In his heart, however, he did not plan to give Salah to her as her husband. He feared he would also die. And that day, Tamar had no choice but to obey Judah. She was at the mercy of Hebrew law. She obediently waits and waits and waits. Finally, after years of delay, realizing that Judah was not going to keep his word, she decides to take matters into her own hands. Tamar dresses herself as a temple prostitute, wrapping her face in a veil, and intentionally puts herself in a place where she knows Judah will pass by. Years have passed, but Judah doesn't recognize her, so he accepts her offer of prostitution. She extracts a promise of payment of the young goat and convinces Judah to leave his signet ring, his cords, which is used like a belt, and his staff as a pledge. Judah sends his servants back with the promised goat, and she has disappeared. So Judah forgets about it and goes on with his life. Tamar's encounter with Judah results in her in a pregnancy, which apparently was her intent all along. When Judah is told of his daughter-in-law's condition, he calls her to account for her actions as a harlot. Tamar confronts him with the evidence that he is the father. Judah realizes immediately that she has tricked him into providing an heir according to Hebrew law because he withheld his son from her. He acknowledges she is more righteous than I. You don't believe me? Just look at Genesis chapter 38, verse 26. This story is hard to understand from our culture perspective. Both Judah and Tamar disobeyed God. Judah had an obligation to give his son in marriage. Sleeping with the temple prostitute was wrong. Tamar chose to make her point by taking the actions of a harlot. One would think God would write them both off and move on to someone else to carry out his sovereign plans. Yet, Tamar is listed in the genealogy of Christ in Matthew chapter 1. She gave birth to two twins by Judah, the youngest, Perez, in her direct line of descendants to King David. In an unusual twist, her name is mentioned when the city elders bless Boaz for taking Ruth, the Moabite, as his wife, fulfilling his responsibility as a kinsman redeemer, a practice not too unlike the Levite marriage custom. It seems to Hebrew people recognize God's grace over Ruth's life as similar to the grace shown to Tamar in bringing it into the Messiah's line. Tamar's story is an example of a desperate actions when we find ourselves in a desperate situation. That's why you can't be too judgmental of someone when they do something, because you never know what situation you might find yourself in. While her position was right, Judah's obligation to provide her with the heir to one of his sons, she chose to take things into her own hands instead of waiting on God. Judah could have very well had denied that he was the father, and she could have been put to death. Yet God showed her mercy and grace and redeemed her actions. She was no longer cast aside, but became part of a redemptive line of Christ. As mothers, we too often make rash decisions in a moment of desperation. Mothers tend to say things, as mothers can say things in frustration, or your mama may say some things in frustration. Your mother may even overstep God's boundaries in an attempt to fix a situation that you got yourself in. A mother might, like Tamar, choose to act instead of wait, yet God's grace still abounds. God rescued Tamar from the mess she made of. If we turn to him, he will rescue you as well. One last example. Scripture tells us about many more women who experienced God's grace in their failures. Abraham's wife, Sarah, only laughed at God's promises in Genesis chapter 18, verse 12, but tried to fulfill one's promise with her own schemes. She convinced her husband using an Egyptian servant as a surrogate in Genesis 16, chapter 2. And when the child was conceived, she grew jealous and bitter and treated Hagar and her son with disdain and hostility, Genesis chapter 21, verse 9 and 10. Yet God chose to use her because he made a covenant with Abraham. He fulfilled his promise just as he said. And Sarah became the mother of the Jewish nation when she gave birth to Isaac. What's interesting is that even after God performed a miracle and given Sarah a child, she still was not the perfect mother. At times, she was selfish and jealous. She was cruel to Ishmael, driving him and his mother away from the family. But now, God never gave up on her. She's also listed in Hebrews chapter 11, Faith Hall of Fame. She is considered him faithful who had promised. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 11, God looked beyond her weakness and her failures and saw her faith. Let me ask you something. Are you a messy mom? Then you're in good company. Don't let your past keep you from realizing the future God has planned for you. Don't let your weakness or failures define your life and keep you from seeing that God has called you to a great ministry, to raise up image bearers for Christ, children who will grow up to love and serve the Savior. Acknowledge your weakness and ask God for help. Repent when you sin and allow God's mercy that are new every morning, especially for messy moms. This I recall to my mind. Therefore, I have hope. The Lord's loving kindness indeed never ceases, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I have hope in him. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 21 to 24. Yes, you might be a messy mother. Yes, you might have made some mistakes. Yes, you may be imperfect. Yes, you said some things you shouldn't have said. Yes, you have made some a mess of some things. Yes, you've made some imperfect decisions. But yet still, God's grace and his mercy abound. God's grace and his mercy shall sustain you. God's grace and his mercy shall keep you. God's grace and his mercy shall hold you together. God's grace And his mercy is the reason why you are still called blessed. I love you, and there's nothing you could do about it. This is how God uses messy moms to fulfill his plan. God bless you, and may heaven smile upon you is my prayer.